This edition of Computer Club Lesson was recorded on March the 21st, 2016. Enjoy! Hello, welcome to Computer Club Lesson. This episode is brought to you by the Binary Guys. Okay, good afternoon, everybody. It's 1 o'clock and time to start. I think I've done a good job of getting hooked into the internet today, so we may be able to get some internet stuff on our computer for you to look at. Once again, I have been an absolute lazy lout and decided about 11 o'clock that we're going to do a Q&A today. So, we may as well do some content that you started us on, or you asked about a few minutes ago, and that's Microsoft Edge. Okay, we'll get, I have Google Chrome up right now, so we'll get rid of that, and we'll bring up Microsoft Edge. And you'll notice when you open Edge, it opens to what Microsoft wants you to see. Yeah, well, it's what Microsoft wants you to see, okay? Unless you're logged into your Microsoft account, or when you are logged into your Microsoft account and you've told the computer where you are on the planet, it will get some local stuff, like Toronto weather. I could refine that a bit to get Hamilton weather, but that's good enough for me. I don't want to use the Weather Network app. I hate it. If you have it, please get rid of it.
Why?
It takes up so many resources on your computer. It takes up half again as much resources as opening the web page does. Oh, okay. So it's one of these apps I don't like. It just completely takes over. Now, like I said, it's what it's showing you here now is what Microsoft wants you to see. Well, what do you want to see when you open up a browser? You want to see the page that you've set the browser to go to when you open it. In this case, I have set it to the home button here to go to Google. I can set that to anything I would like, and I'm going to show you how to do that now. But you're going to have to go about four clicks deep into the settings to do what you want to do, okay? So in this case, I'm gonna go into the settings. The settings are up here. These three little buttons right here will get you to the settings bar, and it's at the very bottom of that list that opens up from the settings bar. There's settings, and we're gonna click on that. Now, it's opened up the settings bar, and it's telling you that it's going to open with a start page. Well, the start page is what it just showed us. What's Microsoft's start page? And I have looked until my eyes ached to find a way to get it to open with Google when it opens, and I have been flummoxed at every turn. You would think that clicking on open with a specific page or pages would do something for you, but I've set that about 9 times and it never works. There's no way to save it. You can do that, and it wants to do what Microsoft wants to do. Okay, well, there's another way to go here. So we'll go further down into the page, and we can see some advanced settings here further down on from in this menu page. We'll click on the advanced settings to view them, and when you do that, you're going to get a few buttons that you can turn on, And the first thing you want to do, because it's turned off by default, is to turn on the home button. I'll turn it off and you'll just see that the home button disappears. Gone. Okay? Gone. All right, so you want to see that home button on. And then when you turn it on, you can put an entry in for what page will the home button be. Okay, so let's have a look at that. I'm going to change this right now to MSN, just for the sake of doing it. MSN.com. And we'll click on save. And at this point, I should be able to go to the home button and click on the home button. And there it goes. It's going to show us what's on MSN.com. You'll notice that some of the stuff on MSN.com was what we were looking at in when the original Edge page opened up. Okay, so it's importing Microsoft content. Well, let's go back and change that back because I don't like that. I never have. So we go to settings and we'll go to advanced settings. And we'll just change that back to Google. Google.com. Okay, and we'll click on save. And there, it's the home button is now saved.
Is that your favorite?
That's where I go to search. Okay, that's where I go to search. Now, the other problem with using Edge and Google is the background search engine, which everybody can see is Bing. Okay. And when you go to the home button into Google and you start searching for something, okay, it's filled in for Malwarebytes. It's gone right to the page that we want it to, malwarebytes.org. But if you start looking down this page a little further, you're going to find all kinds of crapola that Bing, because it's the background search engine, has pulled up about Malwarebytes, and that you can go to File Hippo and get it. Please don't. Please don't touch it. You can go to Google Play and get it, and get Malwarebytes for your Android phone if you want. Please don't do that. There are all kinds of other things.
The first one there, right?
Yeah, there are all kinds of other things, like there's wiki entries. This page in a regular Chrome browser will not be showing you all that crapola. Okay? On the first page, it would strictly show you what Malwarebytes is all about, not all of this divergent stuff. That's Bing doing that.
Can you get rid of Bing?
Not in Edge, you can't.
I haven't been able to.
Yeah, it's not in Edge. Edge is the background default search engine for Edge, and that's it. That's all it's going to give you. So there we go with that. Now, the one other thing that I wanted to show you here in the settings was that you have the ability to zoom the page in and out, but you also have that ability with your keyboard shortcuts of Control Plus and Control Minus, okay? But if you forget the keyboard shortcuts, your zoom function is here, okay, in the settings window. Now, the other thing that it's going to show you here is pin this page to start. If you want to have it available to you, always from Edge, that you can do that, but I don't recommend it. I recommend just, you know, changing it and being done with it. Go through the extra step if you want to use Edge. The other thing that it gives you here in Windows 10, you are able to broadcast stuff from your computer through your Xbox, if you have one, to a television. Okay, so if you've got a movie on your computer, you can broadcast it through Xbox to your television. And you do it with that button, cast media to device. The only thing it knows about is Xbox. So if you want to pay $400 for an Xbox or $600 for a brand new one, there you go. Knock yourself out, but I don't recommend it. You have a favorites button up here. If you're on a web page and you want to keep that as a favorite, you would just click that and that star would turn yellow, that it is now a favorite. And you can go and find favorites by clicking on this little set of lines right here, and it shows you where you've your downloads folder, what's been downloaded in the past, and what your favorites might be here, and doodah, okay, a reading list, and what your folders are, your favorites folders. If you make a favorite here, you can click on this, click on favorites over here, and it'll show you the list. That's the only way to get at it. Okay. Click, 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 click. I hate Edge. So with that said, you don't got to use it. If you are familiar enough with Internet Explorer, and everybody should be, you can use Internet Explorer by simply going into your search bar here and starting to type Internet, X, and there it is, Internet Explorer. Let's open it up. And there's the Internet Explorer we all know and love. Where? Oh, that's how I want it to open. Okay, yeah. It's that's a preference for me.
Yeah.
You can change it around if you like.
Don't know the difference.
Yeah. Okay. Now, there you go. Here's our Internet Explorer, and lo and behold, what do we have here? A menu bar.
Exactly.
Yeah. And if the menu bar is not there, we do as we always do. We go up to the top of the page and we right click. And right click on for menu bar, show menu bar. Okay. Now, Microsoft in their infinite wisdom has said that yes, Microsoft Edge is the better browser to use for just web browsing. And the reason for that is the reason that we always use Chrome or Firefox. It does not have a lot of the feature set of Internet Explorer. Edge is Internet Explorer crippled. So it doesn't do some of the really janky stuff that we have always recommended that you don't do in Internet Explorer, which makes it unsafe to use. But if you want to use it, you can.
How did you get it?
Okay, I entered into the search box down here, just clicked on the search box. Right here, okay, and started typing, okay, and it found the application for me, all right? It found it for me. You can do that with any application you know you have, and you're going through your Windows button and you can't find it, but you know it's there, like Word or WordPad or WordPerfect or whatever you might have. You know it's there, but you can't find it, okay?
You've done that.
Well, here, let me just show you again. I'm going to start typing. Internet. And it started to fill it in all by itself. Internet Explorer. It's also showing that Microsoft Edge is available. And some of the other things that you can do in Internet Explorer. But there you go. That's the application. That's the desktop application for Internet Explorer. You click on that and you get this.
And there's nothing else checked off or put in there? Like you don't have to do anything to that other than click on Internet?
Yep, and up it comes. Now,
what are some of the things that we might do in Internet Explorer, being novices, that you can't do in...
That you can't do in Chrome?
No,
In Edge?
In Edge.
You have more things available to you. And the things that are available to you are easier to get at, such as, like I said before, your menu bar.
Oh, okay.
You can't do a menu bar in Edge. Okay? It's very difficult to do favorites in Edge. But in this, you can drag them to the favorites bar, or when you make a favorite, it's going to go into the favorites menu entry. Okay, so that's what's good about that. If you go over to the right over here, and you click on your favorites star, it will give you what's under the favorites menu. Okay, so it's easy to get at. All right, so that's the thing about Internet Explorer. It still has stuff that's easy to get at. No, I just clicked on the star and down this came. Okay, now the one thing I want to show you here before that little question was that once you've got this open, okay, and you've got Internet Explorer, an Internet Explorer icon down here on the taskbar, if you right click on Internet Explorer open in the taskbar, it will allow you to do some things. And one of them is to pin Internet Explorer to the taskbar. Right now I can unpin it because it is pinned. I can unpin it. And when I close this, Internet Explorer will go away from the taskbar. But I don't want that. I want Internet Explorer available to me all the time. So I right click on it when it's open, and I right click on it, and the second entry from the bottom will be pin to taskbar. You click on that and this will always be available to you. Okay. By the way, this is showing me some of the recent pages that I've opened in Internet Explorer. Okay, if I'm going to something all the time, that's a good way to go and get it. Or if I've forgotten 5 pages ago where I was and I want to go back there, this is a good way to get there.
Would you recommend taking Edge off and not using it?
No. Get used to using Edge because of a couple of things. First off, the internet is going to stop using Flash. Flash is the technology by which you can view movies on YouTube or a lot of other places. The movies that you see are delivered to you in Flash, and a lot of internet pages use Flash to show you nice things like burning text and things that slide in and out of the page. That's usually all done in Flash. That is going away. Flash is just too damn dangerous to use, and Adobe has not been able to fix it. And so the major players in internet browsers have told Adobe, we're not using your stuff anymore. We're going to use some other technology to do this. And so Flash is going to go away in a little while. But for now, Flash is still being used in Internet Explorer. If you open up Edge, and your page is not loading properly, let me just do this for a second here. I am going to do this. G4TV.com. This is one of the most intensive flash pages on the internet. See, you saw those little boxes turning around there? Okay, that was flash loading. Okay, and this is one of the most intensive flash sites on the internet. All of this stuff popping in and up and going in and out is all done through flash. It's very intensive. I'm going to see what it, I haven't done this, so I'm going to see what it looks like in Edge. Okay, so I'm going to put this on again, g4tv.com, and see what we get. Well, it loaded flash, but I think the pages are a little different. Yes, they are. Sizes are different and everything. Yeah. There are differences, but it seemed to be using flash okay. But Edge may stop using flash in the future, in the not too distant future, when there is another technology that most web pages have gone to. And once that's done, most web pages have turned it over, okay, they'll make it so that flash doesn't work anymore. And the last of the web pages, if they want to be relevant, will have to use the new technologies. That's why. They're going to change. They're going to change. Have you tried in try the games in Edge and see if they work.
Well, I only use Edge at the moment.
Oh, okay. All right. The other thing that a lot of Pogo games needs is Java. Okay.
Yeah, I got Java.
Yeah, you've got Java.
Once a long time ago, when this first started, it said something about Firefox, but
yeah,
it never said it again, so I don't know what it wanted to do.
Yeah. Okay. You had a question?
Google still uses, like Chrome uses the Flash. Yeah.
No, there is. It's not. Google is not. Chrome is not using Flash anymore.
Oh.
Okay. So a lot of times, if you're opening stuff in Chrome, and you it used to work, it's not going to work anymore because they don't use flash. They use the more modern modern stuff to show you what's on the web page. If the web page has been written with both flash and this more modern way of writing a web page, then yes, you'll see it. But if it's just in flash, no, you won't see it. And that goes for a lot of the game sites as well. Are you fanning, or did you want to talk to me?
No, I'm fanning. Sorry.
Okay, all right. Okay, that tells us a lot about Edge and Chrome and Internet Explorer. Any other questions about these three technologies? We can look into them a little bit further. Just to repeat, I'm not a big fan of Edge, but if you have not done Chrome on your computer, then yes, go ahead and use Edge for a lot of your searching and stuff. It's a little safer to use than Internet Explorer. Okay. Now,
how come you don't have apps
going in and out?
Like you said, don't they come in on that page?
I think I showed you this before, but I'm going to show you this again. When you click on your Windows button down here in the lower left, okay,
yeah,
it's going to show you this stuff. These are the apps that are available, and applications as well, that are available on your computer. So, like I said, some of them are apps. As a matter of fact, Microsoft Edge is an app. Internet Explorer is an application. There is a difference. Okay? Mail in this is an app.
Is this where you said to take the weather off to get rid of that app?
Well, you can, but if you go into your control panel and into your programs and features, and you find the weather network in there, remove it.
In there, not here.
No, not here, but in there. This is just showing you what's available. If you take this out of here, you have not removed the app. Okay, it's just not being shown to you. Okay, so these are the apps. Flipboard is an app. Photos is an app. Mail is an app.
You don't have a game one.
No, but you do have.
The one above your fingers there. That is
pretty cool.
Yeah, there's a couple of games on here, but where you go to get games is in the Microsoft Store. The only way to get to the Microsoft Store is to be logged in with your Microsoft account. If you log in with your Microsoft account, your computer will change to always log in to the computer on startup from your Microsoft account. So you've got to figure out now, what do you really want to do? If you use the Microsoft account and you've set it up and you use it and you log in, and at login time on boot up, it's going to show you your username at your email account. Now you can set it up as a Microsoft account, you can set it up as a Gmail account, you can set it up as your Source account. Doesn't matter. You can use any account you want for your Microsoft account. When you do that, your computer is available to be synced to any other computer you might have on the Microsoft network. So if you have three computers in your house, they will sync one another over the Microsoft network. So you should have all of your mail will come to your mail app on all the computers. Your contacts will all be synchronized on all computers, so no matter which one you go to, you open up your contacts and they're all there. And a lot of other things, and including the look and feel of the computer. You know, you can, in Windows 7, you couldn't do that, you couldn't synchronize them to look and feel all the same. You had them different on every one. A good way to get confused.
One thing about that with your mail, even though they're synced, only the one where, let me get this straight, on my Windows 10, I've told it that I have Yahoo for my mail.
Right.
So it comes in on my Windows 10.
Yes.
But the folders are empty. Where the content is still in it on my old computer.
Oh, okay. So it didn't.
It says not synced yet.
Yes. Okay. It's not synced yet because Yahoo Mail is like Gmail and is to a large degree is like Outlook. In that the mail that you use is called IMAP Mail. Okay, your source account is called POP, Post Office Protocol. When you download mail from your Post Office Protocol, whatever source had on its email server, it gave to you and deleted from its server. So you can't go back there and find it if you mess up. In IMAP, all of the whole consideration of the account is that it's all on the cloud. Okay? It's all out there. You can log into Outlook.com in Internet Explorer and see all your mail. Okay? You can also use your mail app, or you can use Windows Live Mail or any other local email application and tell it to look IMAP. And so when you make a change locally here, it will be, that change will be reflected on the internet where your mail resides. Okay, so if you delete a piece of mail here, it's deleted there. If you get new mail there, it will show up here as soon as you open the app. Okay? In post office protocol, that's not the way it is. You can tell a post office protocol, download the mail when I open. But when it does that, the mail that's on the mail server deletes from the mail server because it figures, well, you've got it locally now. Okay? And it doesn't care. It's just gone.
Okay, and all the confusion with my computers there. When I go on my mail on my old computer,
yep.
It seems to be bringing it in from elsewhere, which is probably from Windows 10.
Yep.
And it's one page on top of another, and it shows me, like, if I've had a conversation with somebody that I've had five reasons, I've had...
Yeah, there's five entries there.
Yeah,
right?
And they're all there.
Yeah, and when you look in another app or application for your mail, that's not the way it is. That has to do with how you've set your mail to be viewed. So you can go into the view settings and change that. There are view settings for how your mail is presented to you.
Well, I hope eventually I'll get rid of the old one.
But that's how that works. There are settings there to view how your mail is presented to you. All right, now one thing I wanted to show you here, and I showed you once before, but I want you to be aware of this all the time, is, okay, this is the way your desktop is supposed to look, okay, with its menu and its apps, and you can go through these apps, and you can see them all there. You can add new apps. If you've got 100 applications, you can add them into this apps panel and it will grow and you'll see them there. It's just an easy way to get to them. Okay.
Just for fun, would you click on solitaire on there?
No, I'm not going to do that right now.
I want to ask you something.
All right. Well, we'll come back to that.
Do you scroll to get that up?
Yeah. You just scroll through it. You see, there's your scroll bar working there. Okay, I am going to click on something now, and I'm going to change the way this computer presents itself to you. I'm going to go over to this little icon right here, the notifications panel. Okay, and I'm going to click on that. And it's going to open up the Action Center and the notifications that are available on the desktop. And by the way, it's telling me that there's one piece of mail. It here is saying there's one piece of mail available to me. It's also showing me that here. Okay?
Yeah.
Right? And a lot of other little things. But here is one thing that bedeviled me for months. That a client phoned me up one day and said that my computer looks like this. I can't do anything with it. Okay? It looks like this. Look at all that. Where's
touchscreen?
Yeah. Where's my menu? I click on it, I got nothing. Okay? I click on it, I got nothing. Okay, there's my menu, but as soon as I click off of it, it's gone again. I can't get at anything. I can't make anything go. Okay? What you're looking at here is what you would see on a phone or a tablet. All the apps on your phone and your tablet. Okay? It's not a desktop. It's quite something different. And so we got to get rid of that. So we'll go back to our notifications entry here. And we'll click on it. And what I touched before, which turned it on, you'll see now is blue, is called tablet mode. Okay? If somebody has screwed around with your computer and all of a sudden you've got this, you don't have to call me to get out of it. Okay? What they've done is if they've just simply touched this and touched tablet mode. Somebody was fiddling with it. Okay? So you turn off tablet mode and you're back to where you should be with a working menu button. Okay? Now, where do we need to take this? You wanted to talk about and where was it?
Right there. Third from the bottom.
Okay, solitaire.
Yeah.
Okay. I've never played this before, so.
I have. It's right.
Press Win plus G to go to Game Bar. Oh, there it goes. All right. By the way, this appears to be not a program, but an app. Okay. Click games, tiles to play game. Okay, let's play Spider. Okay. You can tell me how to play so I can close this.
Yeah, but now
okay.
This is what I wanted to say.
You cannot play it.
Okay, playing as a guest.
Yes.
Okay, now you're not logged into Microsoft account, are you?
I do. I open it, log in. I open the computer, log in.
Me too.
But
okay,
I don't join Xbox.
Yeah. Okay.
You can.
If the game is there available to you locally on the computer, you can play it. If you're playing it over the internet, you have to be logged into Microsoft's account. It's like playing a Pogo game. Pogo games are not local to your computer. They are played over the internet. And in some cases, these games that you think are should be playing locally are in fact being played over the internet. Okay? So sometimes if you can't get at them, that's why. And playing as a guest, logging in as a guest, might be a way to do it.
I've been doing it since we had Windows 10.
I've never seen it come up giving
Let me just try that again.
Yeah.
And we'll see if we can find the way to do it. Okay, play. So it's loading.
And I do this by
I
don't get this.
See now here it's showing me that I'm logged into the Microsoft account as me.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm also logged into Microsoft.
Okay. So do I say next or just close this? Okay. There we go. So that's what it was. Probably you were going down here, whoever, and you were saying next. Well, if you did next, you didn't get this. Okay. So if you just close the box with its X up here, you'll get that. Play as a guest.
It seems to me all I do is go on Spider,
yeah,
and I get the game, and then that other Xbox one comes out. I don't get these two in between.
Yeah.
I don't get this. It doesn't matter. I just
whenever the Xbox one comes up, just close it, and then play as a guest behind
it. I don't think
it's an Xbox. Well, go through it, fiddle with it.
Yeah.
That's how you should. It should be doing it. It should be playing as a guest.
That's fine.
Yeah.
I don't play that often.
Okay.
One thing about what criteria do you use as to whether you put something on the desktop or whether you put it on the start? I just have a habit of putting it on pin to start, and if I want it, it's there.
Yeah.
If I don't want it, I just take it off. But
yeah.
I notice you use the desktop a lot.
Yeah, I do. Mainly, the reason I use the desktop a lot is because I use keyboard shortcuts a lot.
Okay.
All right. And I'm from that old school of doing one thing at a time.
Yes.
Okay. And I open up the thing I want to use, and I use it. And when I'm done with it, I save it and close it. Okay. Then I go on to the next thing that I want to use. A lot of people will open up four or five desktops and just, you know, go from desktop to desktop. They'll have all their mail on desktop one. They'll have all their documents on desktop two. Play games on desktop three. Okay, so now they're just moving from desktop to desktop. But and that's a fast way to do it. It's a good way to do things.
You don't have Libra on your desktop, but you had it on...
Yes, I do. Right here.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I downloaded Libra on my Windows 10.
Yeah.
And I got two icons.
Yes.
And I don't know why on my desktop. I got one which was the actual download.
Yes, yeah, okay. The one that's the actual download, you can make that go away.
How?
By right-clicking on it.
And deleting it.
Yeah, and delete it.
I thought maybe if I did that, it would
delete no,
the whole
thing. But make sure that what you see of the two icons, there will be one that, where can I go here to show me? Okay, here is this PC. It's not a shortcut because it doesn't have that little arrow. Okay? This folder is not a shortcut to the folder because it does not have that little arrow. If you have the two Libra icons and one of them does not have the little arrow, that icon is the download.
Yeah, I thought
okay.
when I
yeah.
checked to see what.
Yeah, so you can right-click on it and make it go away. Right?
The download.
Yes. Yeah. Or you can put it in your downloads folder. It's a nice place to keep it in case you ever have to load it again.
Oh, you mean, okay.
Right?
Another icon I can put in my downloads folder.
Yeah. In case you ever have to load it again, yeah. You've got it there. You don't have to download it again. Or download the newest version and then try and learn it all over again because it's a new, brand new version. If you've spent months learning Libra 5, and all, excuse me, all of a sudden your Libra download is Libra 7. I'm going to tell you there's a lot of stuff to learn in the new one. You don't have to. Yeah, there is just so much to learn.
Another thing on Windows, on the XP, on the bottom, it shows you, like, if they're waiting on something or how far it's advanced. And
yeah,
you don't get that at all on this.
No, no. There are some things that will show you the how far along a download is. Okay. Yeah, it's a bar or something. There sometimes it's a button that you'll hover over in the. I don't have Firefox here, but in Firefox, there's a button that you hover over and it shows you how your download is going. Other ones are just a box that comes up in behind everything. And you can click on the box and it will come to the front and show you the progress of your download. Yes?
Mine, when I do Google, like if I go to Google and get a download, and the little box comes down in the bottom second.
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
Right
yeah.
from there.
Yeah.
And
it yeah. It in the Chrome browser, if you download something big, okay, it will show you here that you have downloaded something. As a matter of fact, I believe Internet Explorer does that now. It gives you a little box right here that says, "Yeah, you've downloaded it. Here it is." You can click on it right here and activate the download, okay? It just activates the download. You, rather than go to the download folder and find it, it's right there as long as you keep the browser open. Okay? Okay. Now, where do we need to take this now? Any other questions about browsers? And we'll take them there. That's pretty much it for today on browsers.
One thing, Bob, you said with the favorites, if you have Edge and you have favorites, and perhaps you put something in the favorites from Edge, and then you change to Google, and then the Google is your page, not Bing or whatever this startup page is. The favorites that you then download, are they Google's favorites from then on?
No, yeah. They are Edge's favorites.
It's still Edge's.
Yeah, okay. They're Edge's favorites. Okay. So you're going to click on here, and you'll see that your little star is favorites, and your downloads are here, and go back, and all of that stuff. That's all there.
All right. So you're changing your homepage.
Yeah.
Is there a need to clear your history?
Clearing the history. If you don't want people to see what you've been up to.
Yeah, but not only that, I mean, there's some personal things that aren't like just your, if you did banking. Or
yeah, if you've logged into your bank, and it's showing up in your personal history a few days ago that you logged into your bank. If you click on that, it's not going to log you in. It can't.
No.
It will take you to the bank's page where you log in. And if you if you've told your browser, remember me, you will your username and password will be there. If you haven't told it that, your username and password will not be there, which makes it a little safer in case you have people looking at your computer and they all of a sudden they've clicked on your bank page and, ooh, send money to me.
So how would you get rid of history then?
You can, there are,
in there, yeah.
It's in settings, I believe. View advanced settings. Under privacy, you'll find all that stuff, usually under a tab called privacy. If you click into privacy, you will be able to tell the computer to delete all of your history now, or you can tell the computer, delete the history when I close the web browser. And then it will delete the history. And when you open it up again, there is no history. Now, that's not to say that it is also, when you delete a history, you are deleting all of the resources that had to load from that web page. Remember when I did G4? Okay. There's an enormous amount of resources that G4 page has to load on its first crack. Okay. Well, no, that's G4. That's the one I told you was really big on Flash. Okay? Okay. Those resources remain on your computer even when you tell it to delete a history. The resources are still there. So all of the Flash animations are still there. And so the computer will go and look there first to load them. They load much faster from the local resource on your computer than they do downloading them again. Okay? But you can tell the computer, okay, get rid of everything that you've downloaded, out of the cache, and get rid of it all and all of that. It just makes your computer a little slower to use because it has, every time you go back to those web pages, you have to download everything again. Okay?
I empty my cache every once in a while just for the hell of it. So are you saying don't empty your cache because I'm making it slower? Well, can you choose what you empty?
You can choose. Well, no, you can't choose what you empty. You can choose the size of the cache. And I just forget where to look for that right now, right off the top of my head. But You can choose the size of the cache. So you can tell the cache, okay, go to a size of 15 megabytes of resources that you've saved to look at later. Or you can tell it to do 5 megabytes, okay? And so once it gets to 5 megabytes, it will just delete the oldest stuff.
Okay? So what would be wrong with never emptying your cache?
It's going to have a default size. And I forget what it is now. I think it's 60 megs or something like that. Once it gets to 60 megs, the oldest stuff will be deleted and the newest stuff kept. Okay. Does it make your computer a little slower? Not on a new one. On an old grunty piece of iron, it might make it a little slower because it's got to go through that cache looking for stuff.
So when you delete things and you cache that, does it go to the waste paper basket or what's in there? Mine's full.
No, deleting the cache does not put it into the recycle bin. Yes. It just gets rid of it.
So what's in my recycle bin?
What's in your recycle bin is desktop shortcuts and applications that you've downloaded and you've deleted, okay? The recycle bin is a place where you can go if you've made a mistake and undo that mistake about deleting something. Okay? If you've deleted something and your computer stops working properly because you fiddled with it and you deleted something, you can go to the... Do I have mine here? Yeah, there it is, recycle bin. Okay, I've got lots of stuff in my recycle bin. And I haven't emptied this for a while, but let's say that I emptied... I put my LibreOffice download, I deleted it by mistake. It's going to go here into the recycle bin. I can click on that, and I can right-click on it, and I can tell it to restore. It will put it back where it got it.
So
okay.
You can right-click on the recycle bin to get that too.
Well, you just open your recycle bin. Let's do it again. Open your recycle bin with a double click, and I deleted LibreOffice by mistake, and I need to have it back. So I click on it, not double click, just click on it, highlight it, and right click, and it gives me the opportunity to restore it. Put it back where you got it. Then it's gone for good. Okay, now the other way to do that is in the recycle bin. Okay, when it says empty recycle bin, you do that, it's gone. It's gone. Okay. It's recoverable with undelete programs. There's a few of them out there, but only if you've done your delete within a couple of days, because the computer will start to overwrite that area of the hard drive that it deleted stuff from. It'll start to overwrite it. If you can get to undelete quickly enough before the computer overwrites that area of the hard drive, it can usually recover it fully. Okay, but you got to be quick about it. If you wait a couple of months, you're toast. And that holds true for pictures and music and whatever you've done. Okay. If you've deleted a folder full of pictures and you go back a couple of months later and you go looking for it and it's not there, check your recycle bin, see if it's there. If you know you've emptied your recycle bin 2 months ago, you can try an undelete program, but the chances of success are low. If you did it 2 days ago, the chances of success are high. Okay. So there you go. That's recycle.
I go to my recycle bin and go through all the stuff that I've got there and see what I don't want. I truly don't want. I know.
Yeah.
Things,
yeah.
And just leave the rest.
Yeah. Alone. Well, just leaving it in the recycle bin. Make another decision about that. Should I be keeping this? And you can make another folder in your user folder called Hold for Later and put it in there, okay? If you're unsure about deleting something from the recycle bin, maybe the best advice is hang on to it.
Does your recycle bin ever get full? And then
No, your recycle bin never gets full.
Oh, okay.
Yes?
Am I being naive on my mat when I secure empty the trash? Is like I put some stuff in there that I never, is it really gone?
It's really gone. And you're usually on secure empty. What happens when you delete something? When you delete a file, what happens is the computer just takes the first few lines of code from the file and deletes that. And then the computer cannot look and see and divine that because those first few lines of code are gone that tell the computer, I am this and this is where I am and I run this way. If those lines are gone, the computer, as far as it's concerned, your file does not exist. Okay. With secure delete, what the computer will do, in Mac anyway, is it will delete them first two lines of code and then put zeros in for the rest of it. Okay? It'll overwrite it with zeros. So it's gone for good.
That's what I've been going on. But...
Now in the Mac, you may have noticed that if you've tried to delete something, the computer says, no, I'm not going to do it. What's your password? Mine does it all the time because I have program files and stuff. I have files that I've removed from the Mac operating system and put them into trash. And the Mac knows that, hey, these are important. Are you absolutely sure you want to do this? And so you have to tell it, I'm absolutely sure. Here's my password. Make them go away. Okay, that's something particular to a Mac. Windows doesn't do that. You make a mistake, you're toast.
Or somebody else makes a mistake on their computer.
Yeah. Okay, that's pretty much it, folks. That's the hour for today. I hope you've had a good time with it. I'll get this off into a video for you in the next day or two. Next week is Easter Monday. We will take that day off. All right, reminded about that already. And I'll send you an email reminder about taking next week off. Thank you so much. That's Computer Club Listen for today. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.